Welcome, my friends! In this video, we will be introducing the t-distribution and discussing how it can be used to calculate a one-sample mean confidence interval. The t-distribution is often called the student's t-distribution and is named after its creator, W.S. Gossett, who published his work anonymously under the pseudonym Student in 1908. The t-distribution was created to overcome a problem related to the z-distribution. In order to use the z-distribution for confidence intervals and hypothesis testing, the population standard deviation must be known. But this is a very unrealistic assumption, as the population standard deviation is rarely, if ever, known exactly. Sure, it can be estimated with a sample, but its exact value will almost always be a mystery. The t-distribution allows us to proceed without knowing the population standard deviation. In most respects, the t-distribution is very similar to the z-distribution, but there are a few key differences. Here are the characteristics of a t-distribution. The distribution is symmetric about its mean of 0, just like the z-distribution. The distribution is bell-shaped, but the tails are thicker than the z-distribution, making extreme values slightly more common. The distribution depends on what are called the degrees of freedom, which are equal to the sample size n minus 1 for confidence intervals relating to the mean. As the degrees of freedom increase, the t-distribution becomes more like the standard normal z-distribution. We can compare the z and t-distributions using statistical software. I'm using the programming language R. Here we see a standard normal distribution, or a z-distribution, centered at 0. Remember that the t-distribution is similar to the z-distribution, but its shape depends on the degrees of freedom, which are the sample size minus 1. If the sample size is 2, an awfully small sample, then the degrees of freedom are 1, and the t-distribution looks like this. Similar, but not quite the same as the standard normal distribution. Increasing the sample size to 4, so we have 3 degrees of freedom, the t-distribution looks like this. Quite a bit closer to the z-distribution. If the degrees of freedom are 5, we are even closer. Let the degrees of freedom be 30, and the distributions are practically on top of each other, although they are still not exactly the same. This illustrates the fact that as the sample size and degrees of freedom increase, the t-distribution starts to look more and more like the standard normal z-distribution. We stated that the degrees of freedom determine the shape of the t-distribution and are equal to n minus 1. But why n minus 1? The degrees of freedom are the number of independent values that are free to vary in the calculation of a statistic. To give a quick example, if this is our data set, the sample mean is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 divided by 5, which is 15 divided by 5 and equals 3. The sample size n is 5, and the degrees of freedom are n minus 1, which is 4. The reason the degrees of freedom are 4 is because if I told you the population mean was 3, you actually would only need to know 4 of the observations in my dataset to complete the calculation. For example, if I told you the mean was 3 and the numbers were 1, 2, 3, 4, and some mystery number, the only mystery number that will lead to a mean of 3 is the number 5. If the mean is known, the 4 remaining values determine the fifth. If you already know the mean, you only need n minus 1 values in order to complete the calculation, which is why the degrees of freedom are n minus 1. Let's get into the assumptions needed in order to use the t-distribution to calculate one-sample confidence intervals for the mean, which are quite similar to the assumptions we had for the z-distribution used for the same purpose. First, we must have a simple random sample. The value of the population standard deviation sigma must be unknown. If it were known, then we would be using the z-distribution. If the distribution of the data is normal, any sample size will work. Otherwise, the sample size n should be at least 30. This is so that the central limit theorem will apply, meaning the distribution of x bar will be approximately normal. In my experience, the first assumption is often implied, and you should assume that any confidence intervals that I compute come from data gathered by use of a simple random sample, even if I didn't explicitly state it. The population standard deviation is almost always unknown, so the second assumption is very reasonable. The third assumption assures that the distribution of x bar will be normal, either through having a normal distribution or through the central limit theorem if the sample size is at least 30. The first and third assumptions are the same as those for the z-distribution for a one-sample confidence interval of the mean. The only difference is the second assumption, about knowledge of the value of the population standard deviation. Now, as mentioned earlier, the t-distribution becomes very similar to the z-distribution with a higher sample size, in which case the sample standard deviation s is a very good estimate for the population standard deviation sigma. For this reason, some instructors opt to always use the z-distribution with sample sizes that are at least 30, even when the population standard deviation is unknown. This approach is technically less accurate than using the t-distribution when sigma is unknown, but the difference between the results of the two methods is relatively small. Make sure to use the method specified by your instructor. Okay, now that we have the assumptions out of the way, let's look at the general formula for a one-sample confidence interval for the mean using the t-distribution. The formula is x bar plus or minus t times s divided by the square root of n, where mu is the population mean, x bar is the sample mean, t is the positive t-score associated with the desired level of confidence, s is the sample standard deviation, and n is the sample size. Notice the similarity to the one-sample confidence interval for the mean using the z-distribution. The only differences are that we use a t-score instead of a z-score, and that we use the sample standard deviation instead of the population standard deviation. The specific t-score we will use depends on our level of confidence, such as 90%, 95%, 99%, etc., as well as the degrees of freedom, which are n-1. The best way to show you how it all works is just to look at an example, so that's what we'll do now. Suppose a random sample of 16 college graduates found the mean yearly income to be $50,000, with a sample standard deviation of $7,000. The shape of the distribution is bell-shaped and symmetrical. Find a 90% confidence interval for the mean yearly income of college graduates. The first thing to do is to check our assumptions. Do we have a simple random sample? Yes, we do. Is the population standard deviation unknown? Yes, it is. Notice that the stated standard deviation came from the sample, and therefore is not the population standard deviation. Is the distribution of the data normal, or is the sample size at least 30? The sample size is not at least 30, but the distribution is stated to be bell-shaped, like a normal distribution. We have met all three assumptions, so we can move forward with the confidence interval. Here is the formula for the one-sample t interval for the population mean. X bar is the sample mean of 50,000. S is the sample standard deviation of 7,000. N is the sample size of 16. The degrees of freedom are n-1, which is 16-1, or 15. And the confidence level is 90%. The only number that we are missing is t, which is the positive t-score corresponding to the 90% confidence level with 15 degrees of freedom. If we draw a picture of the distribution, 90% of the probability falls between the upper and lower bounds. This also leaves 10% of the probability to be split between the two tails, 5% in each. In decimal form, we have 0.9 in the middle and 0.05 in each of the tails. The sample mean of 50,000 goes in the middle, and the lower and upper bounds of the confidence interval go on the boundaries of the shaded area. The t-score we need for the formula is the positive t-score corresponding to the upper bound. To find the t-score using a TI-84 calculator, we need to know the area to the left of our t-score. The area to the left is these two areas added together, 0.05 plus 0.9, which is equal to 0.95. Now we are ready to go to the calculator. In the calculator, select second, distribution, which is over the vars key, and then inverse t, which is option 4. Put in the area to the left, which is 0.95, and then enter the degrees of freedom, which are 15. Scroll down and press paste. For older calculators without the previous menu, make sure to match this output. Inverse t, 0.95, comma 15. If we press enter, we get 1.753 if we round to 3 decimal places, which is our t-score. Now that we have the t-score, we are ready to plug into the formula. We take 50,000 plus or minus 1.753 times 7,000 divided by the square root of 16. This becomes 50,000 plus 1.753 times 7,000 divided by the square root of 16, which is 53,067.75, and 50,000 minus 1.753 times 7,000 divided by the square root of 16, which is equal to 46,932.25. These are the lower and upper boundaries on the graph. Our conclusion is that we are 90% confident that the interval between $46,932.25 and $53,067.35 contains the population mean income for college graduates. And we are done. Alright, my friends, we have finished our discussion of one sample t intervals for the mean. We will be exploring many more fun and exciting statistical topics that you won't want to miss, so make sure to check out our other videos.